Today, I am going to discuss about design of mission members 2, which is in third year, second semester. Okay? Course objectives. Okay? Before going to discuss about syllabus, whatever the topics in DMM 2, just we are go through the course objectives first. To gain knowledge about designing the commonly used important mission members such as bearings, engine parts, springs, belts, gears, etc. Okay, here the most commonly used parts are what you, if you are taking two wheelers and four wheels, whatever you are taking, the major parts are what? Bearings, engine parts, springs, belts and gears. So we have to know about, we have to understand and how to design of all these things, like what is bearing and how you have to design the bearings and engine parts like piston, connecting rod, all these things, okay, and the springs, types of springs and belts, types of belts, all these things. Next, coming to the course outcomes, okay, the knowledge about after completion of DMM 2 subject, the student will be able to understand knowledge about the general bearing design using different empirical relations and estimation of life of rolling element bearing and their selection for given service conditions. And last, according to whatever the formulas we are getting from the design data book, by using this, how to use the data book and how to design all the different parts. Okay, that are finally the student come to understand. Okay, that is about course outcomes. Next, now the first unit of our DMM 2 is design of sliding contact bearings. Okay, in this, the representation of bearing in this diagram, you can observe how will be the bearing. Okay, next. Now, introduction of the bearing. First, a bearing is a mission element which supports another moving mission element. Okay, a bearing is a mission element which supports another moving mission element, which is called a journal. Okay, journal which is in the inside of the part, and it permits the relative motion between the contact surface of the members while carrying the load. Okay, next. Due to relative motion between contact surfaces. Okay, when the two movements are when the two parts are moving, there is a chance to formation of friction. So due to that friction, there is a chance to loss of some heat. To overcome that loss of heat, we have to use some lubrication. Okay, that lubrication is nothing but the lubricants we are using generally mineral oil refined from petroleum and vegetable oils, silicone oils, greases and other oils may be used. Okay, next. And now coming to the classification of bearings. Depending upon the direction of load to be supported, there are two types of bearings are there. First one, radial bearing. Second one, thrust bearing. First one, radial bearing. When the load is acting radially, then you can call it as radial bearings. When the load is acting axially, you can call it as thrust bearings. We can observe the diagram here. And here, this is the load, the way of load applying here in this diagram, you can observe. Here, the load is applied radially. So, and here the moving element, and it is called radial bearing. Whenever you are coming to the thrust bearing, the load is acting axially. Then you can call it as thrust bearing. Okay, the representation of the two diagrams of radial bearings and thrust bearing is this. Next. And here one diagram is representing how the radial load is applied, radial direction, how the axial load. This is what? Axial direction. Okay, these are the major types, radial direction and axial. Next. Now, depending upon the nature of the contact, okay, depending upon the nature of the contact, and the last one is depending upon the load acting, and coming the second point, depending upon the nature of the contact. Depending upon the nature of the contact, there are the two types of bearings. First one is sliding contact bearing, second one is rolling contact bearing. So, here it is a sliding contact bearing. In between, sliding contact bearing is nothing but in between the two sliding parts, there is no lubricant present. That's what sliding contact bearing. Coming to the rolling contact bearing, in between journal and bearing, there is a balls or rolls are present. That's why you can call it as rolling contact bearing. That is the major difference between sliding contact bearing and rolling contact bearing. Next. Now, coming to the third criteria of different types of bearings under sliding contact. There are three types: full general bearing, second one partial general bearing, third one fitted general bearing. First one, when you are coming to the full general bearing, and here in between general and bearing, it will be rotated 360 degrees. Okay, it will be rotated 360 degrees. Okay, inside the bearing. That's why you call it as full general bearing. And coming to the partial general bearing, it is only rotated 120 degrees angle only, it will be rotated in the bearing. That's why it's called as partial general bearing. And coming to the third case, fitted general bearing. In fitted general bearing, here also the journal is rotating in the bearing only 120 degrees, but what the difference is here, the size, it will be square one. Okay, it will be fitted together. That's why it is called as fitted journal bearing. Next slide, please. Now, coming to the sliding contact varies according to thickness of the layer of the lubricant. This is the fourth type of difference of these bearings. The first one, thick film bearings. Second one, thin film bearings. Fourth one, zero film bearings. Third one, and fourth one is hydrostatic or externally pressurized lubricated bearing. There are the four types of the bearings under thickness of the layer of the lubricant. The first one, thick film bearing. First, the thick film bearings are those in which the working surface are completely separated from the each other. So, whenever it is in rotating position, or when the lubricant is present in the two general and bearing, it does not attach with, it does not meet at any point. Okay, that is what thick film bearing. But here, the thickness of the bearing will be high, and there is at any point the two parts are not meet each other. Okay. And coming to the second one, thin film bearings. Here, at certain points, at higher speeds, the two parts may be connected. Okay, because of the bearing is thin. Now coming to the zero film bearing, here there is no lubricant present in between the two moving parts. That's why you can call it as zero film bearings. And now coming to the fourth one, hydrostatic or externally pressurized lubricated bearings. And here, which can support at steady loads without any relative motion between the journal and bearing. This is achieved by the forcing externally pressurized lubricant between the members. Okay, these are the four types of bearings under thickness of lubricant. Now coming to the working mechanism, wedge action. Okay, and at different speeds, how will be the position? Now coming to the first one, at rest. Okay, at rest, how will be the bearing and how will be the journal? And when the load is acting, it is not in the moving position, it is in the rest position, and you can observe how it will be. Okay, and here the gap, what where we are observed, at that gap the oil is present. Okay, now coming to the slow speed. Okay, now coming to the slow speed, it will be changed somewhat. Okay, here you can observe this is the load and this is the center hole and this is the direction. Okay, this is the position when it starts and it moving with some slow speed, and coming to the high speeds. Okay, these are the three stages and how it will the movements of this journal and bearing. Okay, next slide. Next, properties of sliding contact bearings. Okay, properties of sliding contact bearings. First one, compressive strength, fatigue strength, conformability. Next slide. Embeddability, bondability. Corrosion resistance, thermal conductivity, thermal expansion. Okay, whenever if we are going to design a sliding contact bearings, we have to follow up these properties. Okay, we already studied all these properties. Okay, next. Okay, this is what, how will be the bearing material. Here, the bearing material is given on fatigue strength, conformability, embeddability, anti-scoring, corrosion resistance, thermal conductivity. By studying this table, for each material, how will be the fatigue strength, what are the total properties of these bearing materials is appeared in this table. Okay, if you go through this one, then you can understand which property is high, which property is less. You can understand by go through this table. Next, coming to the lubricants. Lubricants are used in to reduce friction between, as we discussed in the earlier. Okay, whenever the sliding contact bearing, because of these sliding contact, because of the friction, there is a chance to formation of heat. And if you want to reduce that heat, we have to add the lubricant between the two moving parts. So according to that, and here we are using what are the three types of lubricants we are using. First one is a liquid. Second one is a semi-liquid. Third one is solid. Solid. Okay. There are three types of them. First one is liquid. Under liquids, there are minerals, oil and synthetic oils as a liquid or lubricants we are using. And semi-liquid. Semi-liquid is grease, okay, and which is having heavy viscosity, used where high pressure and low velocity exist. And coming to the solid, the most used solid lubricant is graphite. Okay, the graphites are useful in reducing friction where all films cannot be maintained because of pressure of temperatures. Okay, these are the three types of lubricants which we are using in our sliding contact bearings. Now the terms used in hydrodynamic general bearing. Okay, the hydro hydrodynamic general bearing is shown in figure. It will come in the next slide. Hydrodynamic general bearing. The figure represents a hydrodynamic general bearing with different parts. Okay. And here, as we discussed earlier, this is what the outer one is a bearing and the inner one is a journal, and it is what line of centers. And the terms used in hydrodynamic general bearing. First one is diametral clearance, and which is denoted by the C. It is a difference between diameters of bearings and journal. Mathematically, the diametral clearance C equal to capital D minus small d, where capital D is the diameter of the bearing, small d is diameter of the journal. Coming to the radial clearance, it is difference between the radius of the bearings of the journal. And the mathematically, the radial clearance C1 equal to C by 2, where C is diametral clearance, we know, that is capital D minus small d. Next, the diametral clearance ratio. It is the ratio of the diametral clearance to the diameter of the journal. The mathematically, the diametral clearance ratio is C by D, where C is capital D minus small d divided by small d. Now, eccentricity. It is the radial distance between the center of the bearing of the displacer. Next, minimum oil film thickness. It is the minimum distance between the bearing and the journal, and which is assumed as Z by 4. Next, attitude or eccentricity ratio. It is a ratio of the eccentricity to the radial clearance. And other one is a short and long bearing, and it is a ratio of length of the diameter of the journal. Okay, it is journal is less than 1, then the bearing is said to be short bearing, and which is an important one. And on the other hand, the LBD is greater than 1, then the bearing is known as long bearing. Next slide. Next step, design position. Okay, in this I will tell how we have to design the sliding contact bearing. I will tell step by step and which formula used for the designing the sliding contact bearing. The first one, determine the bearing length by choosing ratio of L by D from the data book. Okay, and we can use the data book by M.D. Jalaluddin or PhD College of Engineering. You can use two types of data books. You can go through the data book and whichever we required the data, you can take from that. Okay, where L is length of the journal and D is diameter of the journal, which is in mm. And next, check the bearing pressure. Okay, the formula for the pressure P equal to W by L into D from the for probable satisfactory value. It means P given. P given should be less than the P which we are going to find, okay, which is given in the problem, and which we are going to find, it should be less than. Okay, next, where W equal to load on the bearing, that is it. Next, assume your lubricant from data handbook, which we have to select, then from that we have to select. Next, determine the operating value of the bearing characteristic number or Sommerfeld number, which is a dimensionless number, that is K equal to Zn by P. It is an operating value, K equal to Zn by P, where Z is absolute viscosity of the lubricant in kg per meter second, N speed of the journal in RPM, P bearing pressure on the projected bearing area in Newton per mm square, and which is equal to load on the journal divided by L into T. Okay, next slide. Assume the clearance ratio C by D from data book, and second one, determine the coefficient of friction mu by using the relation. This is the relation, and here one thing we have to remember, whatever the formulas I am showing here in this PPT, every formula you can get from the data book, okay, especially from design of machine members to the data book is allowed to the examination, okay, but it is not in the DMMN because the total fundamentals are included in DMMN, that's why it is not allowed to the exams. But coming to the DMM2, there is no any fundamentals, completely designing procedure only involved in its DMM2, that's why the data book is allowed. And whatever the data in total 5 units, whatever the single formula we are going to use for the solving the problems, which we can get from the data book. Okay. Next, K is factor to correct for end leakage. It depends upon the ratio of length to the diameter of the bearings L by D. And here the values are given. And these values also can get from the data book. Just the procedure I am explaining here. And in this procedure, whatever the value, whatever the formula, you can get from the book data book. Next. Next, the heat generated. Okay, the next formula for heat generated. To find the heat generated, the formula used for this is Qg, which is generated by Qz, and mu into W into V, where mu is coefficient of friction, W is load on the bearing, and V is rubbing velocity, which is pi dN by 60, and N is speed of the journal in RPM. Okay, next. Next one, heat dissipated. Heat determined the heat dissipated. And here it is divided by QD. And which is equal to C into A into TB minus TA, joules per second or watts. Where C is heat dissipation coefficient in watts per meter square per degree centigrade. And A, projected area of the bearing in meter square, which is equal to LNDD. TB, temperature of the bearing surface in degree centigrade. TA, temperature of the surroundings air in degree centigrade. It has been shown by the experiment the temperature of the bearing TB is approximately midway between the temperature of the oil film and the temperature of the outside air. Okay, here the total term TB minus TA is directly given as like this, half into T naught minus TA. This is T naught is outside diameter, A is atmospheric temperature. Thermal equilibrium to see that heat dissipated becomes the least equal to heat generated. Here, how much heat you are taking, and that is QT equal to M into S into T, where M is mass of the oil in kg, S is specific heat of the oil, and T difference between outlet and inlet temperature of the oil in degrees centigrade. And here the S value we have taken 1840 to 2100 joules per kg per degrees centigrade. Okay, here which one, for what we have to find this again, determine the thermal equilibrium to see that heat dissipated becomes at least equal to the heat generated. Okay, in case the heat generated is more than the heat dissipated, then either the bearing is redesigned or it is artificially cooled by the water. Okay, remember the heat generated and heat dissipation. And heat dissipation is more, what the condition is clear, heat generated is more than the heat dissipated, then we have to redesign or cooled by the artificial water. So how much artificial water is required by using this formula? That is the design of sliding contact. That is what the procedure we have to follow to design the sliding contact bearing.